Hi, everyone. It's great to be here. My name is Matias, one of the partners at Founders Fund focused on growth stage investments. And it's great to be here talking about Latin America, given how important the region is to Miami and vice versa. It's a pleasure to be up here with two seasoned entrepreneurs and two very good friends. We have Sebastian Mejia from Colombia, who's the co-founder and president at Rappi, which is the leading on-demand platform for the region with millions of users. And Carlos Garcia, originally from Venezuela, co-founder and CEO of Kavak, which is the leading marketplace for secondhand cars, not only in Latin America, but also other emerging markets. So I'd like to start off a little bit with your backgrounds and your companies, but specifically in the context of the last few years and kind of the roller coaster we've all been on, starting with the pandemic, capital scarcity, then a huge bubble in 2021, now back to a bear market. I think it'd be interesting for everyone to hear how you guys have been navigating kind of all this change and kind of maybe some anecdotes from recent quarters. Maybe starting with you, Sebas.
Yeah, so for you guys to understand, Rappi is basically anything delivered in minutes. We focus mostly on restaurants and groceries. We're serving millions of customers a quarter, probably one of the largest private tech companies in the region. So we've been building the company since late 2015. We had this idea of building a product that was solving these customer needs, but also creating a ton of impact and progress in Latin America. That was always very important for us. And I think we've seen everything that has happened over the last years. One of the things that get me excited about where we are today is that if I look back at Latin America in 2015, 16, it was pretty unsophisticated. I think VC funds were like in the $400 million a year. We are a magnitude of that, even though this year we've seen a pullback, but it's still a much better ecosystem, better talent, better entrepreneurs. Just out of Rappi, probably have 140, 150 companies that have been created by Rappi alumni. So we're talking about way more knowledge on what to build. And I think especially these last couple of years has been tough, but I think it's also bringing the best out of entrepreneurs and you see the real founders building real products that are solving real problems, and I think that applies to Latin America, so that's certainly been our case in terms of everything that we've been doing for the last couple of years, a company that grows 70% year over year in revenues, that generates free cash, that has 60% of its business as subscription, 40% gross margin, so you're talking about a very, very healthy business, and I think it's, especially the last couple of years, have been pretty healthy in what's driving companies to do and what to focus on.
Yeah, I agree. I've been building business in LATAM for the past 10 years or so, and I think when you talk about the volatility that has been happening with the bulls and bears, for us in Latin America, it's been a constant bear throughout the past 10 years where there was no access to capital, inflation has always been through the roof, insecurity and all these things. So we just experimented, one good year in 2021 of, people being bullish around investing in the region. And I think that obviously changes the way you tackle these things and how you operate, through these circumstances. We've just gone back to the fundamentals, first thing that we need to do and that we did was make sure to zoom out. I think when there's so much noise in the markets saying that things are the worst that they have been in years or the best that they have been in years, I think our job is to zoom out and understand, what problem are you solving? Is it relevant? Are you solving it the right way? What size of market are you tackling? Is it still huge? How you're tracking to solve that? And just make sure that, you feel confident around why you started the business in the first place. I think that's the first thing that we did when things started to get complicated in the markets. And make sure that our partners, employees, and everybody reminds why we're here in the first place. Because in between the noise, you can lose a lot of your culture, the confidence around, the business and what you're building, if you're not really able to extract and zoom out and explain, that we're still here to build one of the biggest companies that's gonna come out of not only the region, but potentially, worldwide. And the second thing is the ability to zoom in during these times. I think once you go in these markets, you have to go back to the very basic fundamentals. And the first thing for us has been going back to our customer, understanding if we're working on the solutions that they need, if we're getting better doing that, building a very, detailed business plan on, how we're gonna get our customer experience better, how we're gonna get our growth in the place that we want it, and how do we build a profitable business. and then making sure that you align your organizational structure to fulfill those missions. And it's been a process of last year restructuring the business and just doing less things. I think we're in love with the term fewer, better things these days, getting back to those fundamentals. And this year is, you know, we've spent, when you see, you know, what happens in the markets and when you see the results of the company, those are guided by the decisions that you made 8 to 10 months ago. So now it's just about, you know, guiding the business back to, you know, where it was before all the capital came in and making sure that you build a very, you build a generational company as you go forward, but being very, very strict and with a lot of cadence to make sure that, you know, you are using your resources well.
Yeah, I think people in the U.S., especially tech investors, tech builders, don't appreciate just how different Latin America is from the U.S. Right, on the positives, you have a very fast-growing economy, even though it's, you know, it's been a bumpy road. A lot of rapid adoption. You have some central banks, like the central bank in Brazil, which rolled out Pix, which has been kind of at the bleeding edge of innovation in terms of creating a new payment rail. On the flip side, you have a lot of organized crime, concentration of power and wealth in a few families that are protecting their monopolies. Fraud and all these other issues. And so I think the kind of the bar for building a lasting tech company in Latin America is much higher in many ways. You have to overcome a lot of brutal obstacles and forces you to innovate in a different way than you would see in the US. Could you guys give some examples maybe of like, where have you guys been innovating in a way that your US counterparts wouldn't be, you know, would be doing things differently?
Definitely not Switzerland. So it's a pretty rough place to build companies. But that also means that you're creating a ton of moats because you have to go very deep in everything that you're building. So just imagine any of you guys are in any city in Latin America, you download Rappi, maybe you're gonna buy a salad, you're gonna buy a burger, you're gonna buy a pizza, you're gonna buy a beer, then you're gonna buy pharmacy, then you're gonna do your full grocery, then you're gonna try the fast delivery business that is first party, and then you're gonna become Rappi Prime. And then with all of that information and knowledge that we have about you, we can start issuing you have a credit card, so we have a business in financial services. So for all of that to be true, you have to go really, really deep in the building. We did that in all of the logistics, all of our algorithms, how we run the fleet and do it in an efficient way. We had to do a ton of development and build a lot of technology for fraud. We basically didn't have an infrastructure to jump on, so we had to build it ourselves. But if you actually go through the building, it's hard. It requires capital. Once you get to a certain scale and you can do that with a very healthy business, scale effects are real, and then you start opening up all of that infrastructure. So today, we have a consumer business, but we also have a business-to-business business, which we're opening up all of that infrastructure for businesses to jump on Rappi, to do logistics as a service, to do marketing as a service, to run payments, among other type of products that we have. So I think it's really hard. The other thing that I think it's critical, and I'm seeing it now, is that you have world-class talent, talking about some of the best operators in the world that are choosing to come and dedicate their life to building in this part of the world. I think that's a relatively new phenomenon. And that's creating this incredible transfer of knowledge, not only for these people that are learning about Latin America, but they're transferring their knowledge to an amazing group of talented builders and entrepreneurs that are basically coming from Latin America, and that connection is very, very powerful. So I'm very, very bullish about that effect, and I think we're just seeing probably 2 years of that. So that's gonna continue. So yeah, hard, but definitely very, very moody and very different from what you see in the U.S. So I think I hate when they give me the this of that, your this of the U.S. because it's very different once you understand the product. And you cannot be asking superficial questions as an outside investor. And also, the same applies to what Carlos was saying about the macro and the politics and the inflation, et cetera. Like, we've had that all along, and our customers still need our product, and the market is still there. We're talking about a region that is 40% the size of China, twice the GDP of Southeast Asia. So if you get on the surface and you don't go deeper on your questions, I think you're gonna miss the opportunity in LATAM.
Yeah, I agree, and I think, you know, I'm gonna try to break it down to a place where we can understand it. But the market is very different, you have different customers, different dynamics. The infrastructure that's laid out in LATAM is very different. So you basically don't have infrastructure on most of the things that you need to build the business. So you have to, when you're gonna build the business, you have to build several businesses to make your business work. And when you have all of these macro issues that Sebas has mentioned, and I think for us, you know, when you lay it down to our experience, if you're gonna buy a secondhand car in the US, you have CarMax, you have dealers, you have all of these solutions. If you're gonna do it in LATAM, 90% of the market is informal. You can only do it with, you know, strangers. And because there's so much fraud, there's lack of information, there's no DMV where you have your car registered. Like, your car is owned by just, you know, a signature and a paper that if somebody steals it from you, it's theirs. So you have, you know, 90% of the transactions being done informally, and because of that, 40% of them end up in fraud. And that makes, that fraud is really relevant. You know, some people get killed, kidnapped, to losing a ton of their money. Before you get into the issues of buying a car secondhand that has mechanical issues. So that fraud issue is what, you know, makes the market really different. And because you have so much fraud, you have nobody financing these transactions. In the US, 90% of whatever you're gonna buy, you can finance, even in used cars. In LATAM, it's only 5%. So there's less accessibility to own a car. So when you think about the problem that you're solving a fraud issue and you're solving a financing penetration issue. In the US, seven people out of 10 have a car. In Latin America, it's closer to 1 out of 10. So the problem that we're solving is moving that 1 to 7 and getting more people into cars through access of financing and making sure they don't get defrauded in the process. And to build that, you have to build a completely different solution to do that because you don't have the formal infrastructure to build it. So you have to build a business where you buy these cars because there's no auctions. You have to build a business where you recondition these cars, manage the warranty, the services, the full thing. Because customers in LATAM, you have to remember that we never had laptops. We went directly from not having internet to having smartphones. So smartphone penetration is double than what you see in the US, same, you know, in terms of social media. So it's a market that feels a little bit more like China. So the solutions that you have to build cannot be transactional. You have to build lifetime value solutions where, you know, through an app you offer multiple services. So strategically, you have to build very different business. I think you have a different mood. I think it's tougher to build, but if you build, you have an opportunity to be alone for a while. And if you're building complex company like ours that are not only technological companies, but that have, you know, real infrastructure underneath it. And definitely, you know, the challenge is getting to scale velocity. And it's taken us years to do that. And now we're starting to see companies like Rappi, like Kavak, you know, generating billions of revenue. And it creates confidence into, you know, investors outside of the region to understand that LATAM is a great frontier for investment. It's a great frontier for building great companies. But the formula is not going to be, you know, the typical software formula that you've been seeing in the U.S. for the past 10 years.
And so to double-click on one of the comments you guys made around the talent, we've seen a lot of kind of up-and-coming founders in the region. The quality of founders keeps going up consistently as you see people flowing outside of Mercado Libre and Nubank, but then also people who've worked in U.S. companies go back to their home countries. How do you guys think about that balance between developing that local talent that can take you to where you need to go, but then also maybe attracting U.S. executives? And what will be your pitch for people coming from the U.S. tech companies to come build with you in Latin America?
Yeah it's so a lot of the playbooks of how to build this company, we basically had to kind of invent ourselves. So we had plenty of mistakes. A lot of things that, I mean, I think any founder would say that, but I would go back and do very differently. But we were also experimenting and learning, and I think that also created unique solutions on the problems that we were facing. But once you get to a certain scale, you realize that the complexity of building a company of this dimension, it's just really large. So you kind of almost need to build a different operating system for your company, right? And that's not easy. And when you look around, the ingredients of that is people. And when we look at the, at least we started in this process, and who are the people that have done this in Latin America before, you don't find a lot of names. So the immediate thing that you need to do is, okay, where are those people? And you realize that there's people that have seen scale that are great builders that have done similar things in the US or that have managed very large businesses. So I think that once you identify those people is how do you actually get them attracted about building a company in this part of the world? And what I've learned is that first you gotta evaluate genuine curiosity, genuine sense of adventure. I interview differently, so I just go deep into the intrinsic motivation of the person and the character. So I need to like dissect that and like we cannot bring an executive that is then telling people what to do if it's not really building with the team. Like the culture of Rappi will completely eat that person alive. So if there is a genuine curiosity and a willingness to learn, as well as influence people and teach, that's a very, very powerful combination. So it's the pitch is that. The pitch is a genuine sense of adventure. The pitch is live a great life, have fun. Like Latin America has a lot of exciting things. It's a great place to live. The pitch is also building something for the first time, building something at a real scale. Lack of wokeism. We don't worry about any of that shit. We're like really building, talking with our customers. I feel a lot of refreshment from people that come from US companies as soon as they enter Rappi and they're like, wow, like you guys push super hard, but there's so much love. And it's not like me, my ego, no, like you guys are really, really building. So I think that plays a part. Not all of it was our job. I think we were also lucky. There was an external factor, which is COVID and people working remotely. So that helped, but